And it's been too long since we've talked, but I know you've been busy working on this book. And so we talk about going back, and I want to go way back to the very beginning, because I want to talk about the Garden of Eden. And the first question is, Carl, is was it a real place? Because a lot of people just look at this and say, well, that was just mythical.
Yeah. Well, listen, thanks for asking that. Wow, that's an amazing way to ask it, because the answer, I think, will be pretty profound. Listen, everything I'm going to say, and I'm doing this quickly for the sake of radio interview time, but everything I'm going to say is backed up by dozens of scholarly attestation, Hebrew and Greek word studies, modern-day scholars, ancient scholars, classical scholars in my book. So I just want folks to know that. Yeah, the answer to your question is this. The Garden of Eden, if we believe that the Word of God, the Bible, is the Word of God, and I do, and I guess a lot of your audience does, then here's the bottom line. The Garden of Eden was real. Adam and Eve were real. The sin was real. The fall was real. My goodness, if you don't think the global fall was real, just take a look around, right?
Yeah.
But the bottom line is all of that is real. Now, the image of the walking, talking snake and the offering of a piece of fruit from a tree, all of that is metaphorical. Now, why do I say that so emphatically? Because the rest of the Bible says it, all the way through from Genesis to Revelation. Literally, in the book of Revelation, it defines those elements as metaphorical. Literally, all of this is documented heavily in my book. Again, scholars have been seeing this for ages, but people just don't want to deal with it. Because the bottom line is, what happened in the garden was presented in a metaphorical sense in Genesis 3, but you hear me, what happened in the garden? Because again, from Genesis to Revelation, the Garden of Eden is mentioned. Literally, the last chapter of the book of Revelation mentions the Garden of Eden. Literally, from Genesis to Revelation, the Garden of Eden is mentioned. The tree of life is mentioned. It's defined for us. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil is told what and who that was and what all that was about. The eating of the bad fruit was, we're told what and what that was about foundationally. The walking, talking serpent, the metaphor, we're told, was not a walking, talking snake, but it was Satan himself. God says that in the Old Testament clearly. The Scriptures say it. The New Testament says it. Jesus says it. The book of Revelation says it. And I know a lot of your listeners are thinking, well, gosh, I've never seen this. Where are you getting all this? That's why they need the book. I've spent years preaching and teaching this stuff, showing people this stuff. They've been freaking out because they see it right there in the Scriptures. They think, my gosh, how come we've never connected these dots? But the bottom line is, yes, the Garden of Eden is real. It is coming again. It is going to be the restitution of all things. The Garden of Eden will be restored. Our divine nature, just like Adam and Eve, never dying, no more pain, no more crying, no more death. It will be restored for those who are under the blood of Jesus. And but the character of the walking, talking snake and the imagery of trees and fruit, that imagery is used in several other places in the Scripture very clearly, and those are metaphorical. Again, I know these things because the Bible says these things, Rob. I hope that makes sense for this little bit of time I have to share it.
It does. We're talking with Pastor Carl Gallups. The new book is Gods of Ground Zero, The Truth of Eden's Iniquity, Why It Still Matters, and the Mystery Surrounding What's Coming Next. We're going to have a free copy of the book to give away to a lucky listener coming up after the break, so stay with us. We'll make that announcement, and we'll also let Pastor Gallups tell you where you can buy a copy. So let's get to this whole narrative of the walking, talking serpent. And why was that imagery used? Why did God use that instead of just saying, well, Satan was there walking around? Because people have a very visceral reaction to snakes, at least most people do. I don't like them one bit.
Yeah. Well, listen, that's a great question, and I answer that in the book, so I'm so glad you asked it. It's for several reasons. First of all, it's a play on words, and you don't see it in the English, but in the Hebrew you do see it. In the Hebrew, the word is nachash, for serpent. Now, that can be used as a literal snake, a literal serpent, but it also has deep connotation in the Hebrew to mean a person, a literal being, a human being or a created being, like a demonic or an angelic, that is deceptive and that lies and that is out to trick you, to seduce you, to beguile you. And that's exactly what Eve says to God when God questions her. He says, but Nakash beguiled me. And she calls him the serpent, but that's because the term Nakash can mean serpent, and a lot of English translators just translated it to the literal. It's similar in our English word, but the Hebrew word has much deeper connotations. It's used throughout the scriptures, and it's never again translated as a walking, talking snake. It's always translated as someone, a person who beguiles someone, a liar, a deceiver. But in our own English language, we use the word snake that way. I can say to you, Rob, there's a snake in your garden. I think it's a rattlesnake. Well, now you know I mean a literal snake.
Yes.
But we can be standing in a room full of people, and I say, uh-oh, look at that snake in the grass.
Mm-hmm.
There he is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I've just used the same word. But I mean two different things by it according to the context. Well, when you say, yeah, but the context of Genesis 3 is literal. No, it's not. If you read the rest of the Bible, it's not. We never hear of a walking, talking snake again anywhere in the Bible. But we do hear of Satan called a serpent and defined all the way back to the Garden of Eden. He's called Nakash. And we're told he's not a serpent, but he was a guardian cherub, one of the living creatures right from the throne of God. In fact, we get to the book of Revelation. All the way at the end, in chapter 12 and chapter 20, we hear this statement. And the serpent, excuse me, and the dragon, comma, the serpent, comma, who is Satan, that ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, it says in Revelation 12. There's just one example. We can go back to the Old Testament where God tells us that he was an angelic being and not a walking, talking snake. So in Revelation 12, it says that ancient serpent, who is Satan. Well, how ancient was the, quote, serpent? Well, all the way back to the Garden of Eden. Well, but who is he? Well, Revelation tells us. And by the way, the book of Revelation is the most profound revelation we have on the entirety of the scriptures. And it says that was Satan. It was the devil. It was Satan. It wasn't a walking, talking snake. And then if you keep reading Revelation 12, excuse me, it speaks about how the serpent spewed water like a river to overtake the woman, to sweep her away, and the earth opened its mouth and swallowed the river that the serpent had spewed. Well, that's all metaphorical. There's no such thing as a snake that can spew a river of water and that the earth opens its mouth and swallows the river. It's all metaphorical. So when you take what the rest of God's Word says, and by the way, again, because of radio interview time, I'm only sharing two or three examples of dozens of examples like this in the scriptures that my book outlines. When you take everything else the Bible says about the Garden of Eden and go back and look at the Garden of Eden account, it'll blow you away as to what really happened, what it was really all about, why it is so important, how it ties right into our headline news, how it ties into our daily life, and how it ties in to the return of Jesus Christ and the kingdom that is to come. When Jesus taught us to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, there was a reason he prayed that. The Garden of Eden ties the entirety of the rest of the Bible together, right down to the last words of the book of Revelation, but today's church in America doesn't have a clue. They've missed the connection entirely. They've turned it into a children's bedtime story with a little walking, talking snake giving a woman an apple, and the rest of the world laughs at us. And it's because we haven't done our due diligence of biblical scholarship. And so what I've done is I've connected all the dots. I've backed it up with the attestation of dozens of scholars. I've done the Greek and Hebrew word studies so that people can see it. Anybody sitting in a pew in America can understand this book and enjoy it and get a ton out of it.
Let's go to the break, but before we do, Pastor Carl Gallups, would you tell people where they can get a copy of your book and get more information on your ministry?
Yes, it just officially released a couple of days ago, so you can get it anywhere books are sold, good books are sold, Christian and secular bookstores. If they don't have it in stock, they can certainly order it because it's on those order lists. But if you shop on the Internet, of course, Books A Million, Barnes & Noble, Amazon shipping right now, and then you can find out everything about me. You can actually read three or four chapters, plus see the whole table of contents at my website. Go to carlgallups.com. Right across the top of the page, page, you'll see a big banner, Gods of Ground Zero. Click on it. That takes you to the book's website, and take a look at all of that information and scroll down where it says Look Inside. Click on that, and you can read the first three or four chapters free, plus look at the table of contents. You can get a good idea of where everything is going.
Fantastic. We continue this conversation for our final brief segment on the other side with Pastor Carl Gallups. I will also have a free copy of the book to give away to a lucky listener after the break, so stay with us and be listening for that announcement. And when we come back, I want to talk about the implications of what happened in the Garden of Eden for today and why it still matters. Stay with us. The Shilling Show back in just a moment. All right, heading into the final segment of the Shilling Show, Wild Wednesday edition, we continue with Pastor Carl Gallups. The new book is Gods of Ground Zero, The Truth of Eden's Iniquity, Why It Still Matters, and the Mystery Surrounding What's Coming Next. And right now, to caller number 5 at 977-1070, I have a free copy of this book. I know you'll enjoy it as I did. It's really eye-opening and written in a very accessible way, so it's not going to drown you in things that'll make it hard to understand, but actually really reveal some things in a very straightforward way. Caller number 5 at 977-1070, a free copy of the book. So I want to go to the other part of this, because we've spent, and we don't want to give away the whole premise of the book because we want people to read it and take the time with it, but we spend a lot of time about the serpent, and now I want to talk about the fruit and the tree, if we could please, Carl, in our remaining few minutes.
Yeah, okay. And by the way, how long do we have total?
All right, so we've got about another 3.5-4 minutes at this point.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, we're okay. Tight on time. So
that's going to be difficult to unpack in 3.5-4 minutes, but let me just say thank you for your kind words about the book. Here's the bottom line. The fruit and the tree are metaphorical. Now, there are many places that make this very clear. The Old Testament speaks of it. It speaks of fruit and eating of the fruit of a tree, what that implies, what that means. Sometimes it can be good, but many times it also is associated with evil, perversion, and of course, Eve was told, do not eat from this tree. It is evil. It's both good and the knowledge of good and evil. In other words, it'll start off good, but it'll turn to wickedness. We get all the way to the New Testament, and we hear Jesus in Matthew 7, Sermon on the Mount, his first public sermon on a hillside with tens of thousands of people there. He starts it off in Matthew 7, where he doesn't start the sermon off, but very shortly into his sermon, he starts talking about, be careful about the bad trees that produce the bad fruit. Do not eat the bad fruit from the bad trees. There is good fruit from good trees. Well, what do you think Jesus was probably referring to? All the way back to the Garden of Eden, there were two trees. One of them had the fruit of, quote, the knowledge of good and evil. The other one was the tree of life. Gee, the tree of life certainly was the tree of good fruit. The tree of knowledge of good and evil was the one of evil. Then Jesus keeps going, and he speaks in Matthew 7 about the trees, and he calls the tree that produces bad fruit, he calls that the false prophets. The false teachers, the ones that will lead you away into sin, do not follow them. Do not, quote, eat their fruit. Now, these are the words of Jesus, and this is just one of about 10 examples like this I show in the book that are all through the scriptures. So what did Satan do in the garden? Who was the first false prophet in the whole cosmos? It was Satan. See, that's why the Garden of Eden, I call it Ground Zero. That's where the first terrorist attack took place. Mm-hmm. It's where the first lie took place. It's where the first death sentence took place. It's where the first judgment of God took place. It's where the first prophecy of the coming Messiah took place. That's Ground Zero for the story of life, much less the story of the Bible as we have it from Genesis to Revelation. And so Jesus is saying, be careful about these bad trees that produce bad fruit. They are false prophets. They will lie to you. They will lead you astray. They will destroy you. Stick with the good trees that produce the good fruit. Eat the good fruit. Again, what in the world do you think Jesus was referring to? Of course, he was referring all the way back to the Garden of Eden. How was Satan a false prophet? He walks into the garden. Genesis 3 starts with, and the serpent. We never hear of the serpent before. Mm-hmm. And then he starts talking. Really? A walking, talking snake that's smarter than Adam and Eve? Mm-hmm. That can outsmart God's new creation? Really? No, it's a metaphor. Just like Jesus said in Matthew 7, what did Satan do? He called God a liar. and he issued a false prophecy. He said, God, surely God didn't say that. Surely God didn't mean that. God knows. Listen, you will not die. Surely you will not die. God just knows you can be like us if you do this, if you eat of this knowledge. And so that's my quick answer. I go, as you know from reading the book, much, much deeper than that. But I just want people to know this is not a children's bedtime story. It's not a Sunday school coloring book story. This is the reason for everything. It's the reason why you and I struggle with our sin nature. It's the reason why all 7 billion of us on the planet are lost if we're not under the blood of Christ. It's the reason why Jesus had to come and go to the cross and rise from the grave, why he's coming again, why he's coming to Jerusalem, why he's ruling and reigning from there. It ties everything together all the way to the coming of the new Jerusalem, which is described as the recreated Eden in Revelation 22, complete with the tree of life, right there, restored again. This explains the entirety of the Bible, the entirety of life. It explains the headlines, why there's so much demonic focus upon the Temple Mount, Jerusalem, Israel, the Church of God, the people of God. It's all about the Garden of Eden. I hope that makes sense in my short time.
It certainly does, and we have just a few seconds left for you to tell us once again if people want to get in touch with you, get a copy of the book, how they can do it.
Yeah, carlgallops.com, carlgallops.com, there it is. I've been a pastor for 33 years of one church, spent 11 years in law enforcement prior to that, two different sheriff's offices, have a lot of experience under my belt. I've been reading and writing and preaching and teaching, peer-reviewed for 35 years, and I'm not pulling this stuff out of my back pocket. This stuff is heavily researched, but put in a way that everybody can understand it.
Pastor Carl Gallops, it's always a pleasure to speak with you. I enjoy so much reading your books, and I thank you for joining us today on The Shilling Show.
It is my pleasure, Rob. Thank you for having me. God bless you.
God bless. And we will do it again, and it's going to wrap up today's...